Good evening, everyone. So it is a great pleasure to welcome Professor Nitin Nitsure from TIFR to give today's colloquium. And so Nitin is well known in the mathematics circles for his contributions in algebraic geometry and more specifically for his work on modelized spaces. I can count at least half a dozen faculty in the math department who know Nitin as their teacher, including me. So he's one of my teachers. So it's a great pleasure to have him here. He's well known for his great lectures, and personally, I never miss a chance to attend his lectures. So today he'll be speaking on molding 3D curved structures by selective heating.
Thank you, Amit, for the kind introduction, and I'm very happy to be here to get a chance to speak to this audience. I always loved coming to IISER, and I envy the great atmosphere that you guys have. Now, coming to the subject of plastic molding, I should tell a little story of how I got involved in this. So I have a friend called Shankar Ghosh, who is my collaborator in my physics work. And Shankar told me one day that there's a kind of plastic called Shrinky Dink. I had never heard the name. And it is used as a toy, and you can draw some pictures on it. And then it's baked in an oven. And then it shrinks, and the pictures start looking something. So his question was, can you use this Shrinky Dink and the idea of heating it to produce different shapes? And in particular, he said, where you draw that is black, that heats more and therefore contracts more, can you use this kind of selective heating and selective contraction to produce whatever you want? That was his question. So I could immediately begin to answer it. Between the question and the first shape molded, half an hour passed, 5 minutes to explain the answer and 25 minutes to mold it. But then eventually, we developed three different methods of doing it. And doing things experimentally is very complicated, which a mathematician like me did not appreciate before actually seeing what happens. So I won't talk much about the experimental aspects. I will more talk about the ideas and a little bit of mathematics, which is involved in the ideas. So there we go. So, as I said, we had developed three methods, and the Shrinky Dink is what is called as a thermoresponsive plastic, big word for saying that it shrinks on being heated. You can see lots of YouTube videos of children playing with Shrinky Dink. I didn't know that till recently, but there are many such videos. These methods do not involve any cutting and gluing, which is a property they share with origami. Origami is also something which takes a flat sheet of paper and tries to make interesting shapes out of it. So I said there are three methods. The first method is inspired by tailoring of clothes. The second method tries to bring about the desired new intrinsic Riemannian metric. Whatever that means, I'm going to explain. I'm very mindful of the fact that many of you are from different subjects than mathematics or relevant physics where you know such words. And so I'll take care to explain some of the things. Of course, later there can be question answers. The third method seeks to induce desired local distances. Now, why this third method in spite of a second method? That also I'll explain. And some of these methods, especially the second and third, are algorithmic. That means if somehow you have some way of communicating what is the shape you want in some numerical manner, then the program converts that information into a picture. This picture you print on this plastic sheet using your computer printer. After that, you take that printed piece of plastic and put it in your oven, or in our case, under an infrared lamp. Then the black painted portions heat more and they contract more, and this piece of plastic takes the desired shape. So all that is done by a computer program, what to print. And so I'll explain the theory and I'll show photographs of some shapes that were molded by these methods. So this is my collaborator, Shankar Ghosh, and this is his PhD student who helped do the experiments. And the preprint we loaded last week on the archive. A year ago, we had loaded the first version, but almost everything changed between then and now. And so whatever I don't explain, if you are more interested, you can do search on archive and download the paper and read more about it. There's much more in that than what I'll be able to explain in 1 hour. OK, so so let me repeat myself. Also, newer people are coming in. So there's a kind of plastic which is available as flat sheets. And this plastic looks a bit like the transparencies which were once used before this PDF file and this forward, forward, forward. We used to put those plastic sheets and then remove it and put a new one. That kind of plastic, it almost like that. That also apparently contracts a bit on heating, but it doesn't contract sufficiently. This shrinking contracts quite spectacularly. So as I was telling you some time back, Shankar had this idea that we can contract a selected portion of a piece by painting it black and exposing it to radiation. So how to mold the plastic sheet into a desired shape by such contractions? And I already said this is like origami. Now at this point, you may ask, OK, you seem to have material which contracts on heating. What if you had some material which instead expanded when heated? Would you be able to use that to make any shape? Answer is yes. Same techniques with some minus sign somewhere in the mathematics will do that, or one upon in the mathematics will do that. And what if you need to expand somewhere, contract somewhere? Can you do all that by contractions? Yes. So that is what I call a C trick. I named a trick for doing it a C trick. So any one of expansions and contractions suffices. While fiddling with this, I saw that one needs a constant C somewhere, and so I started calling it C trick. So I decided to name it C trick. Okay, so let's see. So the first thing is tailoring. When this question was put to me, my immediate response, almost instantaneous, was, tailors, after all, begin with cloth. And cloth does not have any particular shape. It's flabby. I'm going to use the word shape in a rather precise technical sense later on, and I'll explain that. But you definitely understand what is meant by cloth being flat. On the other hand, the human body is curved and has a certain shape, whatever that means. Again, I've used that word shape. A circus tent is curved and has a shape like a hemisphere. And after all, these things are made by tailor or by, well, so circus tents may not be made by tailors, but they are made by tailoring. So how is that done? And the answer is this. So to make a hemisphere, you can take a disc. And you can cut wedges out of the disc. Because you see, if you look at the hemisphere, as you go along, the circumference increases, but not all that much. It is kind of gathering together. Yeah? Or you can think of a bowl kept on ground. And then as you go along the radial direction, you might have traveled a lot, but the circumference has not increased all that much. It has come in. If you want to make something like a modak, you'll want to bring in the circumference even more and pinch it. Even though this radius, if you want to call it radius, is quite a lot, the circumference has actually shrunk to a point at the North Pole. So now if you want to, so how does a tailor do this? He cuts out wedges. And then when you cut out a wedge, there are two edges. those two edges you stitch together. This is how you contract the circumference. And as you go further, the circumference needs to be contracted more and more. So your wedges should get broader and broader. Now, any wedge naturally gets broader. It's an angle after all. But what you mean is more. If you just keep a fixed angle and cut out wedges and stitch the two edges, what will you get? You'll get a cone, because there will be a fixed angular deficit all through. So that's a cone. But for a sphere, you need to broaden the angle. So the wedges will have a certain shape. They'll get broader and broader. And so you cut out those wedges. And if you want to make it rather uniform everywhere, you, instead of having just one wedge which you are cutting out, you'll split it into several wedges which have the same net deficit in angle, and stitch the edges, and then you'll get the hemisphere. So this produces something of positive curvature. I'm going to explain what's the meaning of the word positive curvature and its opposite negative curvature, in between zero curvature. But this is something of positive curvature, remember. The human anatomy also has portions of negative curvature. The waist has negative curvature. And now, how do you make a shirt or a dress fit your waist? So you might have seen shirts which, here behind, have some eye-like shape cut out of them. And then the two edges are brought together. As a result, the circumference is decreased here in the middle and is more on either side. That produces a negative curvature. So again, there's something being cut and the two edges brought together. Sometimes tailors don't cut it. They just bring those two things together and that results in pleats. The old-fashioned trousers, this doesn't seem to have any, but had pleats. So you don't have to cut. You can simply fold it and bring it together as they do in origami. They don't cut anything. So I'll say what is meant by curvature. But now I'm going to explain what is positive or negative curvature in a very simple way. So you take that bowl and you put your hand in it. And your hand will have to bend like this in order to touch the bottom of the bowl. But you rotate your hand, and in any direction, the hand has to go like this. Bend the same way, backwards. You feel it in your muscles. Or if you do it from outside the bowl, from the outer side, everywhere you'll have to cup your hand in the same way, like this, as well as like this, like this. As against this, think of something like the neck or the waist. If I want to fit my hand to my waist, I have to make it curve one way. And if I change the direction, I have to make it curve the other way. This is what happens in a mountain pass. There's a road, and there are mountains on either side, and this is the pass. And so one way like this, and the perpendicular way, it's like this, two opposite ways. This is the mark of negative curvature. What's the mark of zero curvature? The mark of zero curvature is these two perpendicular directions where the curvature is extreme. At least one of them should have zero curvature. So a cylinder is like that. One way it is like this, but the other way it is zero. Okay, so that is what is positive, negative, and zero curvature. Curvature also has a magnitude, and all that is given in standard differential geometry courses, and you don't need to know too much to appreciate the main points of what I'm saying. Okay, so now you understood what is meant by positive curvature, negative curvature, etc., and I explained to you how a tailor produces positive curvature as well as negative curvature. Yeah? And if he does nothing, then the cloth already has zero curvature. So now, the first thing I'm going to explain is how to tailor a surface of revolution. What's a surface of revolution? A surface of revolution is one, says that there's some kind of an axis, and if you rotate the surface around that axis, it looks the same. So a sphere, for example, or a cylinder where you take that rotation axis to be the axis of the cylinder, or a cone, or all kinds of things. There's very simple kind of things. So let's look at how to make them. So here's a picture. Here's the surface of revolution. I have cut it open in this picture. And the circumference is not going to grow as much as it would in the flat case. There's going to be a certain deficit, as I explained. And so that deficit I have shown there by black. So actually, this has a lot of circumference at a given radius along this. But if I go along the same distance along this, then the circumference is less, and the deficit is this black portion. So if you somehow contact this black portion, you'll get this interesting shape. Of course, you should divide that black portion into several wedges and place them all around the annulus, and then contact it to get a more uniform effect. So that's what we do to get interesting surfaces of revolution from a flat disk by contraction induced by heating. Now, there are some practical difficulties here. So I must tell you that this shrinky-dink thing contracts by a certain factor, which is about 0.5, at about 100 degrees centigrade. Between 90 and 100 degrees, it starts contracting and finishes its contraction. And below that, it doesn't contract appreciably. Above that, it remains more or less at that same level of contraction. Now, if you want to paint it black, the black portions have to be of at least a certain size, because if they are below that, even if they try to get hot, the heat will flow away by conduction to the neighboring area rapidly, and they won't heat to the required degree. So you need them to be of at least a certain size. If you make them too large, again, there are problems of overheating and folding and melting and tearing and whatnot. So you have to keep the size, the breadth of this black wedges in a certain effective margin. All such experimental details are in that archive paper to which I have given reference. So that's why you have to divide this into a number of things. How many things will depend on how far you go. You might have to change the number of things in which you divide it and then paint it. So the computer program, the algorithm we have, has all these things coded in it. So given a surface of revolution, and a surface of revolution is given by a simple function, and then which tells you how much circumference you want at what radius. Just this one function, and then it makes the coding of printing, and then you print it and heat it. So let me show you the kind of things that we can obtain. So here's a picture. This is a hemisphere, and it's obtained like this. So this is the black thing which has shrunk to become this. Actually, it was much bigger, and it has shrunk and become this. There's a side effect. It looks very artistic, but it's a side effect. Namely, this wedge that we drew, look at the last page. This one has this boundary also, and just as this shrinks and brings together this and this, this thing just comes in. And that is what has produced this petal-like effect in this picture, which you can see clearly, a petal-like effect. Here is a petal-like thing. Same here. Here you can see the number of such black wedges needs to be increased because the thickness keeps growing. So that any one of them is not too thick, we had to make several wedges instead of one. And so this shape has come out like this. You can see that here the curvature is negative. Around this portion. Around this portion, the curvature is positive. Here's one more picture, and I want to show you something, a geometric complication which can arise in this method, which is this. If you compare these two surfaces, the circumference at a given radius, and the radius is measured along the surface, the circumference as a function of radius is the same for this and this. It's like a hat which, you know, you have these shapes, umbrella is one of them. You can suddenly push it down or it can come up. It can be like this or that can suddenly curl up. It can do so without tearing because after all the circumferences are the same whether it bends this way or that way. That's why there's this ambiguity. So it can jump there or there if you in between use its elasticity and push it through. So now given that our method only uses circumference as a function of radius, how can we selectively mold this or that? And the answer is very interesting. You see, in our method, when we have this plastic and we paint it on one side by computer printer, the ink gets applied to one side. So after that, when we place it under an infrared lamp and on a turntable and all such very nice experimental arrangements, the side on which the printing is done heats more than the opposite side. So it contacts more. Because it contacts more, it shrinks more on that side. And you know there's a famous gadget or a famous piece of technology called a bimetallic strip. It is made of two different metals stuck together, which have different expansion, which means contraction coefficients. And so when you heat it or cool it, one side contracts or expands more than the other, and as a result, the strip bends. And it is this strip which is used in thermostat of the old kind to make or break your circuit when it reaches the desired temperature. Refrigerators, ovens, all kinds of things use such bimetallic strip. So we can exploit that effect. In this picture, we want this to come up, and while we want this to go down. So if you want it to go down, this portion should be painted from the other side. And that will do it. So we can selectively mold either one of these. So I explained to you just now, and this I shouldn't call tailoring surfaces of revolution. These are not surfaces of revolution. These are all kinds of other things. After all, nobody says that we have to apply this only to surfaces of revolution. We can apply it to anything. Tailoring is an art. But when those are surfaces of revolution, we are a simple algorithm. That's why the computer program we have written for surface of revolution. All other things, there's no way of easily classifying it and making tailoring programs out of them. But for our other two methods, give us anything and we have a computer program which is okay with anything. So tailoring being an art, tailors are some kind of artist, of course, as you know, and a skillful tailor may try to make anything for you. Now here's a little caveat, of course. When I say anything, those of you who are topologically savvy must have thought, but then you're making it out of a flat disk. Whatever you get is homeomorphic to the disk, as they say. Meaning, homeomorphic simply means made from a disk by stretching, contracting, but without tearing. And not anything can be made like that. Yes. So if you want to make things which are not topologically a disk, homeomorphic to a disk, then you will have to think of it as made up of a number of pieces, each one of them homeomorphic to a disk, mold each one of them, and then you will have to glue them by methods which are not this, but some other method of gluing. Okay, so having done with tailoring, now I want to explain what is metric and how to so mold things that a desired Riemannian metric come about. For that, a small recall of basic geometry. So I want to tell you what are local coordinates. And for that, let me take my surface to be a sphere. This is called S is for sphere, and 2 is because the sphere is two-dimensional. When a mathematician says sphere, he only means the thin surface of the sphere. And if you also have the interior, it's called a solid ball instead of being called a sphere. Probably the only ball which mathematicians saw was cricket ball, and they never knew football, what it is. But ball means solid and sphere means thin. So the thin sphere only has a surface, so it's of two dimensions, so this is S2, and it sits in R3. R3 is this three-dimensional space, and all of you are familiar with that notation. And so this sphere is defined by this equation, which means its center is going to be origin and radius is going to be R. So I'll show you what are, this is a sphere, okay? And what is drawn are latitudes and longitudes, curves of constant latitude. These are the circles of constant latitude. These are the circles of constant or semicircles of constant longitude. They are all geodesics, these are not. Only the equator here is. So around any point other than the poles, around the poles this doesn't work, you will have to choose some other two points as poles and now redraw latitudes and longitudes if you want to work at the North Pole. But otherwise, latitude and longitude serve as local coordinates. Let's call them U and V. Now, the distance between two points when traveling along a surface is the least when we travel along a great circle. That's the geodesic. So if you're asked, you take this sphere, imagine it's a planet, take a motor car, place it on the sphere, lock its steering wheel in the straight position, and start it and drive it. Where will it go? Those curves are called geodesics. That's all that there is to it. Geodesics are the curves that will result if you walk on a planet without turning, or drive a car on a planet without turning. Okay? So obviously, this is not a geodesic. In order to go along this, you will have to keep turning left. So if you want to keep on traveling east in the northern hemisphere, you have to keep turning left. And if you want to keep traveling west in the northern hemisphere, you have to keep turning right. This is very obvious if you are very close to the pole, because when you are very close to the pole, if you start going fixed east or fixed west, those are very tiny circles around the North Pole. So obviously you have to turn. So those are not great circles. So what are the great circles? What are the geodesics? What will a car travel if you don't turn your steering wheel? It will travel along the greatest possible such circles on the Earth. The equator is one such. It's the greatest among these various circles. It's called a great circle. Yeah? These great circles can be obtained by cutting your sphere with a knife such that the cut passes through the origin. So if you take a lemon and cut it anywhere, you will get a small cross section. If you cut it through the center, you get the biggest possible circle. Those are the great circles. Yeah? Those are called geodesics. The analog of this is there on more complicated surfaces. They are called geodesics there. Now when you travel along a geodesics, you are going to travel a certain distance. That is the shortest way, at least for nearby points, to go on the surface from one point to another. Now, all this is because I want to say that there is no easy formula for the distance along geodesic. You can't say, okay, give me a formula in terms of latitude and longitude for the geodesic distance between two points whose latitude, longitudes are given. You can write that formula, after all, it will be too much hard work and will involve some integration of something and so on. And it won't be a simple Pythagoras-like formula. Because this Pythagoras-like formula, where you take two perpendicular directions and add the squared length to get the squared displacement, yeah, only works in Euclidean space, only works in something flat. And as all of us know, and we knew till our school teachers convinced us that the Earth is round, all of us knew that the Earth is flat, right? Everybody knew that till some modern geographers, geometers, whatever convinced us otherwise. And so in the small, the Pythagorean formula works, though not in the large. So this is it. This is the thing. Unlike in Euclidean space, the Pythagorean formula applies on a curved surface only in the small, and that is approximately so. So when you apply this Pythagorean formula in the small and not in the large distances can be obtained by summing together the small distances. And when you take smaller and smaller, that's a certain limit of sums. That's known as integral. I think all students learn this much mathematics, that sum is replaced by integral when you sum tinier and tinier things, divide into more and more, and pass to limit of this sum, you get integral. So the name for this technology is called Riemannian metric. Okay, big name, but it's just this. It's Pythagorean formula in the small and a kind of summing up replaced by integration. Okay, so because it's a Pythagorean formula, it's quadratic like this. Du means a chota u, tiny displacement in u, du. And I never heard of differential forms, nothing. Okay, so this tiny thing, you move and you square and add. Except that now there's a cross term and there are coefficients. That because your coordinates need not be perpendicular to each other. If your coordinates are not perpendicular to each other, you will get a cross term like this. And the coefficients are not one because your coordinates, displacement in coordinates is not proportional to the distance traveled. Therefore, you need to scale it up or keep it down by having a factor. So this is how small distances can be measured by the Pythagorean formula, which takes this form, and these coefficients together are called Riemannian metric. Some people like to use indices, and then they'll say U1 and U2, and they'll call these things as G11, this they'll call G12, this they'll call G22, and then that's high mathematics, and this is low mathematics, so it's the same thing. So this is the Riemannian metric, or the first fundamental form. So we just now saw I have sphere and it has latitude and longitude. And then x, y, z can be written like this in terms of latitude and longitude. And so the Riemannian metric in this case, which is just converting this into these coordinates, turns out to be this. And if you compare this line with this line, you find that E is this, F is 0, and G is this. F is 0 because the latitude and longitude are always perpendicular to each other. So there is no cross term. If they were not perpendicular to each other, there would have been a cross term. All right, so now I'll explain what is curvature very rapidly. So unlike the Earth, which is uniformly curved all over, though geographers tell us that it's a bit flat at the pole, something, something. But a general surface has a different amount of curvature in different places. So this Gaussian curvature is a function of where you are. And the really interesting and at that time shocking thing for people was that this Gaussian curvature is completely determined by the Riemannian metric. And it does not depend on how you have put that thing in R3 so long as the Riemannian metric is what is the same. So let me give an intuitive meaning to the magnitude of Gaussian curvature. They define Gaussian curvature through tensors and crystal symbols and all kinds of things. And just to show that I also heard a bit of these things, I have a next slide which alludes to this briefly. But I want to tell you more hands-on what is Gaussian curvature. So here is a formula. So read this. This is very, very easy. Could have been told to a 12th standard student. So on this curved surface, you are very pig-headed about it. You know your Euclidean geometry. You know that circumference is 2 pi r. So you draw a circle and you find that circumference is not 2 pi r because you have molded it, you have brought the circumference in, or you have stretched it out more and made it even more. Whatever it is, you measure that circumference. To measure that circumference, all that you are going to need is how to measure little distances, divide that circle into tiny segments. Each one has a length given by the Riemannian metric. Add it up. So you get the circumference of the circle. And it's something CR, let's call it CR. It depends on the radius, of course. Now, the expected answer in the flat case is 2 pi r. You subtract what you actually get. Divide by r cube and pass to the limit as r tends to 0. What you get is the Gaussian curvature, but for a correction factor of 3 upon pi. If you stare at this formula, you will see that this deficit or excess, whatever it's going to be, is like r cube. You know, when r is small, r cube is very small. When r is 1/10, r square is 1 upon 100, and r cube is 1 upon 1,000. So this means this deficit is going to be comparable to 1 upon 1,000 when the radius is like 1 upon 10, which means really this deficit is minuscule. It's a high order infinitesimal effect, third order infinitesimal. It's a very tiny effect. No wonder that when you are marking, when an architect is designing a building, he doesn't have to bother. These effects are really very tiny. Okay. Another way, so you may say, okay, I know that circumference is 2 pi r. I also know area is pi r square. How about that? Okay, you can use that also, and that's called formula of decay. So let AR be the area of a tiny circle of radius r around the point P on the surface, then the Gaussian curvature is a similar limit. So again, look at this. Pi r square is the expected area if it was flat. This is the actual area you have obtained. This time you have to divide by r to the power 4, 1 upon 10,000, that tiny. So you have to multiply this difference by 10,000, really blow it up for it to be visible. You are dividing by this r to the power 4. So it's a very, very tiny effect. And you have to put a correction factor of 12 upon pi on what you get. And that is the Gaussian curvature. Okay. So these two are very nice formulas. And those of you who are indeed mathematicians and fiddle with these things and know some definition of Gaussian curvature, other definition, try to prove them as an exercise. Okay. So I'll rapidly go through slides which show you what it is in more sophisticated terms. You don't need to be shown this if you already know it. And if you don't already know it, this rapid showing is not going to make any difference. So, but you can remember the name Brioche formula. And you can Google Brioche formula and read it if you want. That's a simple way of writing it in EFG. The surprising point, as I keep emphasizing, is that only E, F, and G matter, and now not any more information of how it is placed in R3. So long as the same E, F, G are obtained, curvature is the same. So in practical terms, I have a sheet of paper. Its curvature is zero. I roll it into a cylinder. Curvature is still zero because the distances measured along the paper have not changed because I have not stretched the paper to tear it or I have not contracted it. But how now it sits in R3 is completely different. That information is not there in the first fundamental form or the Riemannian metric. That information is there in the second fundamental form. Okay. So now my question, can we do molding to bring about the desired new Riemannian metric? So you have a piece of plastic, it becomes something. So there's a map, an old point becomes a new point, right? This is called a map. When you draw a map of the Earth, say, map of the world, whatever, it's a flat piece of paper, and on that you have marked that this is this island, this is this mountain, whatever. Each of the points on the paper corresponds to a point on the Earth. This is what is called a map. So suppose I have a map, and the word does come from geography. So if I have a map from a flat piece of paper to a curved surface, then each point on the plastic, which is actually some point there, has a new Riemannian metric, has a new EF and G coming from that curved surface. It already has one metric, which is the flat Euclidean metric, which is given by the Pythagorean formula. But it has a new one corresponding to what you want. So can I convert the old one into the new one by doing something to the plastic? So this is what is written on this slide. Suppose we want to mold this given thing. The idea is we begin with a flat piece of plastic and change the original flat metric, which is this, to get the desired new metric. And that begins with a map from D to M. Such things are shown by arrows in mathematics. And then we pull back the Riemannian metric to get a new Riemannian metric, which we express in terms of these coordinates x and y on D. We express the new metric on M in these terms. And we want to bring about E, F, and G. So what will change? What will change in very practical, simple terms is, what are tiny circles on your flat piece of plastic will become ellipses on that curved surface. So when you have a big geographic map, tiny circles on the Earth will become ellipses on your piece of paper, or circles on the piece of paper will correspond to ellipses on the Earth for tiny enough. And what's the difference between a circle and an ellipse? How to make a circle into an ellipse? This is the question. And the answer is very simple. To make a circle into an ellipse, you choose the major axis and minor axis. You have to identify two mutually perpendicular directions and stretch them appropriately, or that may involve contractions also. Stretch or contract each one of the two perpendicular directions by the given factor, and your circle becomes an ellipse. Very simple. So, of course, sometimes the circle remains a circle, can become a somewhat larger circle, somewhat smaller circle. Then there are no unique two perpendicular directions. You can take any two perpendicular direction, and the stretch factor in either case is the same. Okay, this is what it visually means. This visual knowledge, which I just now gave you, is called the spectral theorem of self-adjoint operators, and is at the heart of a whole lot of mathematics, physics, quantum mechanics, all kinds of things. Okay, but in this simple setup, it simply means how to make a circle into an ellipse, how to compare these two. So this is that. Now let's apply it. But I have to explain to you my C trick, because sometimes it may involve expansion, sometimes it may involve contraction. The idea is very simple. Let me put it first in words and then show you a picture, and that's it. And I will not explain the formulas. Suppose I know that I need to stretch, not just contract. And I know, I only know how to contract, but I have the knowledge that I need to stretch. What should I do? Answer, I should begin with a much larger piece of plastic. If I begin with a much larger piece of plastic, then no further stretching is required. Already it's too large. So now all that it needs is contraction. This is the C trick. And I can use the same thing if I only knew how to expand, and sometimes contraction is needed. Begin with something very tiny. It's already too small, so there's no need for any further contraction. Now all that you're going to need is expansion. Perhaps you won't need much expansion and keep it that tiny, where otherwise you would have needed a lot of contraction. That's all. That's my C trick. And here's, here's a picture. So suppose I want to mold this shape from this. It involves a lot of stretching, you see, because a tiny thing here has become slanted and therefore longer. And therefore, this says you first make a uniform contraction and then go there. Then the overall, the composite as it is called, will only involve contractions. Yeah? So now I can, so my metric molding problem now is how to make a circle into an ellipse with two different contraction factors in two different directions. So let me do it. Okay, before that, this one little picture, ignore it for the time being, or maybe to the end. And let's come to this basic idea. So suppose these are the two directions, and I want a lot of contraction in this direction and a bit of contraction in this direction. In that case, I will draw a thick black band like this and a thin black band like this. And suppose each one of them becomes half of what it is. So this thick black band has become this half of it. This thin one has become even thinner. So as a result, this green square that I have drawn on it has ended up being this green rectangle. This is the idea of two different contractions in two different directions. Very simple idea. Now the problem is, when I want to mold something, the directions are going to keep changing. And the magnitudes are also going to keep changing. How do I handle changing directions and magnitudes for these contractions? For that, I'll divide my plastic into a lattice. And each of the lattice square will be appropriately molded. So here is one lattice square. And it has this kind of design. And it becomes that each one of them, these squares, is going to end up being a certain parallelogram. Under this, when circle becomes ellipse, I gave you a nice symmetric starting point circle, so I could quickly say it will become an ellipse. But your starting point may be a rectangle, which is not at all aligned with the major and minor axis. So what will that become? It will become a parallelogram. What has that parallelogram? How do you read off the stretch factors and directions from that parallelogram? That is done by something called polar decomposition of a matrix. Remember this word polar decomposition. Go look it up in Wikipedia or anywhere. And this polar decomposition is what we strongly use in our paper. Okay, so this is the method. This is the basic design. You'll see that this basic pattern is bordered by something black. The reason we border it by black is the two neighboring patterns could be very different. But if it's bordered by black, then this intervening black region, which heats, absorbs a lot of heat because it is black, becomes soft. And when it is soft, it can deform, and that leads to the interpolation between these two different orders for contraction in different directions by different magnitudes. The in-between black region interpolates between them. So with this design, we can mold all kinds of things. So now I'll show you pictures of metric molding. So here's a surface, here's another, and these pictures, well, okay, we have photographed it and we can rotate and see those photographs also, but if you come to TIFR, you can see the samples kept. Sometimes these pictures, I cannot very easily see the three-dimensional pattern out of these. But yeah, this is a saddle and this is that. OK. So now we come to this issue of non-rigidity. This is a subtle issue, because as I said, something like the cylinder and something like, say, a cone have the same Riemannian metric, which is a flat one, have the same Gaussian curvature, which is zero. But they sit very differently. Okay? So how can we selectively make different surfaces which have different Gaussian curvatures? And we can do that in many cases. And this, therefore, we developed a new method, which we call metric molding. Okay, so bear with me till I show you a slide which exactly explains the issue. So suppose I have two different surfaces which have the same Riemannian metric. And so they have the same curvature. Do they have the same shape? So let me make now the word shape precise, but first the same Riemannian metric. This means there's a correspondence between M and N, a 1-1 correspondence, under which this Riemannian metric becomes that Riemannian metric. Then I'll say that they're the same Riemannian metric. Okay? So each point there has a corresponding point there in such a way that the Riemannian metric there and the Riemannian metric there correspond to each. And same shape will mean, after all, if I have shape in R3, something embedded in R3, I can translate it, I can rotate it, I can take its reflection in a mirror, and I can make a new shape. Those I'll regard as same. Right? So when I ask you to mold a bowl, you might make that bowl somewhere there. That's OK. I can translate it and bring it here. When I say a sphere, the sphere could have been anywhere. When I say an ellipsoid, an egg, egg could be like this, egg could be like this, egg could be like this. I can rotate it and make it that egg. When I have right hand, you might mold left hand. That's mirror image of that. I'll come to the issue of chirality in a moment, sometime. So the question arises, if the Riemannian metrics are the same, are the shapes the same? And they are not, as I explained to you with the example of cylinder and plane. So a surface in R3 is called rigid if any other surface with the same Riemannian metric has the same shape as M, which means that is obtainable by this one by rigid transformation, translation, rotation, reflection. And so the answer to that question is, there are non-rigid surfaces in R3. A sphere is rigid though, but a smaller portion of a sphere is not rigid. And there are lots and lots of non-rigid things. Therefore, the metric molding method will produce something with the desired intrinsic Riemannian metric, but will not produce something which is uniquely specified up to translations, rotation, reflection. So how to get that? So this is the idea, how to get that, is distance molding. The idea is this. So we have chosen a map, which is everywhere a local contraction, which we can, by the C trick, which means begin with something much larger, and therefore it will be everywhere a contraction. And instead of directly, the spell check didn't catch this. OK. Inducing, that means there is such a word in the dictionary. I should look it up. So instead of directly inducing the desired new intrinsic Riemannian metric on D to turn it into M, which may fail due to lack of rigidity, we divide D into a pattern of triangular tiles. And we try to contract each of those tiles to change the distances, actual distances, as embedded in R3. We change those distances to bring about the desired new distances. So what should we do to each tile? How to make these tiles cooperate with each other so everything fits together nicely? Because these instructions will keep changing. The surface is differently curved in different places. It's turning differently. So when I make this pattern, it should be able to accommodate all that. And so here's the answer. Now, if you look at our preprint, you will see the quantitative explanations of what exactly are the thicknesses of this and so on. So there are formulas. We solve some equations to get how thick should be this yellow band to get what factor of contraction. You have to solve some simultaneous linear equations, two variables. Very simple kind of mathematics does the job. And we give this quantitatively, but here I'm going to hide the quantitative part. And so this is the kind of pattern you do on a tile. This yellow part is what is painted black. If I do that, I won't be able to see these symbols, so it is painted yellow for the diagram. And so in making something like this, these triangles are fitting together. You see, these are the triangles. And so they are these weird shaped white portions which emerge because the curving is changing the parameters of how I need to contract each triangle. And now you can imagine what's happening as some kind of plate tectonics. Imagine these white things are plates on a molten planet floating in the yellow lava. And the lava is going to contract by a certain factor, drawing these plates together. And these plates are of shape, size, whatever, angles, so that when they do that coming together, what you get is not the flat shape that you started with, but the desired new curve thing. This is the idea. Okay, so let me show you. This is a diagram to get this. You see how they start getting weirder as you move to the boundary, because this is becoming more and more vertical here. So here are some distance molding examples. This in particular is something which has the same Riemannian curvature, same Riemannian metric as a portion of a sphere. Forget these two singular points where it's pinched, because you see, one definition of Gaussian curvature is you take these two extreme directions where the curvature is extreme and see what is the curvature of that plane curve obtained by cutting it perpendicularly. Curvature of a plane curve is easy to describe. If I have a curve in a plane, I want to know how much is the curvature at a point. Very simple. You drive your car along that curve and how much do you have to turn the steering wheel? That is the measure of that curvature. Simple. Okay? And in other words, you try to fit a circle. When you're turning, it's as if you hold your steering wheel steady, you're going to go in a circle, right? So how much steering wheel you have turned, keep it fixed, and you'll go in a circle. Look at the radius of that circle. Bigger the radius, straighter the road, right? A straight road is a circle of infinite radius. So what you have to do is 1 upon that radius to get the curvature of a curve. Now, this is the definition of curvature of a curve. Drive your car along it. At any point where you want to know the curvature, hold the steering steady. Your car will leave the road and will travel on a circle, measure its radius, take 1 upon that. So now when you have these two mutually perpendicular curves, take their curvature and take their product. That is the Gaussian curvature. So for a sphere, both these directions, perpendicular directions, have the same curvature. In this shape, we have increased the curvature in this direction and decreased in this, so the product is the same. So there's a whole family of surfaces which have constant Gaussian curvature, positive one, which are more and more opened up in this direction and more closed in the other. And same you can do with negative curvature. So these we could mold by this metric molding. Okay. Now, I'm just going to show you a picture. We are not just able to mold shapes, but we are also able to produce pattern surfaces by a pattern of heating. I won't dwell on this. So let's come to the issue of left and right. So some surfaces are chiral. You want to mold this instead of this. How do you do it? And that we can do in many cases by exploiting the bimetallic strip effect. The bimetallic strip effect can be used to, on what side you paint, makes it achiral. So if I cut some alphabet, I cut the alphabet N. Well, is it English N or Russian N when, in three space I can flip it around. But suppose the ends are curled up a bit. Now you know. You so place it so that the ends are curled up a bit, then it's unambiguously one of the two. How can you make the ends curl up a bit? By the bimetallic strip effect, right? So you can exploit the bimetallic strip effect to induce chirality, the desired chirality. Okay, this is the answer of how to make selected chirality out of this method. Now I'm going to talk about some limits on molding, and this is the last slide. So you see, the material that we began with has a certain contraction factor. And this contraction factor is something between 0 and 1. So if I make it completely black, it will contract by the factor gamma. And gamma for the commercial Schencky Dink which we used was something like 0.5, I remember. Now suppose gamma was 1, then molding is not going to work. Then it's going to retain its old length. If gamma is 0, that means you can contract as much as you want, all the way down to vanishing. Of course, physically impossible. What will happen to all that mass? But anyway, gamma equal to 0, limiting case where there are no geometric bounds on what you can, how much you can contract. But the actual gamma is in between. And this puts limits on molding. Now, the interesting point is, for our particular methods that we have chosen, we calculate what are the limits on what we can do as functions of gamma. But we also prove a result that regardless of what method you use, meaning a foreseeable future method, whatever it may be that we don't know, there are limits on molding which are functions of gamma. So I'll show you such a result. So regardless of any hypothetical method of molding, suppose I want to make a portion of sphere which is all but a little cap around the North Pole. If there's no limit on molding, I can make North Pole minus a single point. North Pole minus a single point has a stereographic projection on the sphere, right? Sorry, on the plane. And the portions nearer and nearer the North Pole get usually expanded out there on the plane. So in order to make them into sphere minus one point, you'll have to usually contract them if you want to use the stereographic projection and the necessary contraction. Of course, you can do it if gamma is finite, not zero. But regardless of whatever method, the portion of the sphere that you can make has this bound. We cannot produce a portion of the unit sphere which is of the form, this is the portion where this is an inverse function of this function. The proof is in that preprint. Okay, so this is all I have to say. Thank you for your kind attention.